I gotta say, since Dr. Sleep opened overseas last week, I've actually gotten a number of tweets from some of you about how much you enjoyed Dr. Sleep, right? And I really respect that position, especially because so many of your tweets seemed so genuine. And it has an okay Rotten Tomatoes score, right? I mean, it's slipping a little bit, but you know, it's certainly, the film's certainly not getting trashed. And it makes me wonder, because I didn't like this movie, okay? It makes me wonder that how many of the people who enjoyed this film saw Kubrick's The Shining, right? And because it's, you know, a lot of people don't watch old movies, unfortunately. But, you know, that's just the reality that we live in. It's something that Warner Brothers, to some degree, maybe doesn't have to worry about, right? Because when, if you did watch The Shining, when did you watch it? Like, you might not remember very much of it. And I would recommend you not watch The Shining before seeing this movie. And how many of you, by the way, enjoyed The Shining? Because a lot of people didn't care for that film when it came out. It was, in fact, very poorly received. And I'm sure even today, some people, it's just not their cup of tea. But I loved The Shining, and I did not care for this movie. And here are some of the reasons why. But I do find the fact that some people like this movie so much interesting, and I'm curious to hear your thoughts down below. So here again, here's why I didn't care for the film, why I don't think that it works. It's, for me, it's more Stephen, and also as a sequel to The Shining, the movie, not the book. So on that note, I feel it's more Stephen King than Stanley Kubrick, right? This didn't feel like a sequel to 1980s The Shining whatsoever. In fact, we don't get to the Overlook Hotel until the last 30 minutes or so. It felt like even less time of a 2.5 hour movie, right? And when we do get there, everything is a mere shadow of the film, and not in a things from one's childhood seem different than when you're an adult. Like, that would have been an interesting take, but that wasn't the case. I mean, it was fun to be like, oh, they got the production design just right, and that's the same wallpaper, and the boiler room did look just like that. But that wears off very quickly. And something they didn't get right was Jack Nicholson and Shelley Duvall. They have actors playing those roles, and they're so bad. Part of me felt that Mike Flanagan, writer-director Mike Flanagan, maybe intentionally went in the other direction. He's like, I'll never get anyone as good as Jack Nicholson and Shelley Duvall, so I'm just going to get people that are horrible, because no one can hope to compare. But I was talking to a friend of mine, and she pointed out that maybe nobody wanted to try and play Jack Nicholson and Shelley Duvall, so this was the best caliber actor that was willing to give it a try. But I have to say, considering how it turned out, I would have preferred weird digital stand-ins of the Jack Nicholson and Shelley Duvall to what we get here. I mean, it was just almost sad. And on that note, I wouldn't call this a scary movie. I would call it an extremely sad movie. A lot of bad things happen to truly good people with very little justice. It's almost Pixar-y in a way. And people, some people do like that about Pixar, right? I mean, now sure, certainly in life, bad things happen to people and there is no justice. But that's not very entertaining, especially when the story you're telling has no real message to make it worth your while, right? It's like you want to just sit through a lot of really sad things and you're like, that's not really what, I mean, that's not what this movie sells itself as. It was like really sad. And again, not in a compelling or interesting way. It was just like, oh, I feel so bad that that happened to that person. Although that is a credit to the actors. I thought the acting was very good, which we'll discuss. I also feel the movie sucks a lot of the scariness out of The Shining. For instance, they show the woman in the bathtub so many times, and she's so ineffective. There are no repercussions. She's, you know, they keep saying she's a danger, but we don't see it. That the visual, which is so iconic from the movie, by the end of this movie, it becomes comical. And I thought that was a shame. I also felt the movie didn't deliver. Basically, you've got telepaths fighting on the astral plane, right? Like, when you get right down to it, that's what's going on here. And while Dr. Sleep offers an awful lot of buildup and teases hugely powerful telepaths about to duke it out, those battles, when they do happen, and again, that's rare, are surprisingly short and small in scale. I would think you'd have to have a huge blowout battle at the Overlook, and I was expecting that, and I didn't get it. Which was very surprising as a choice, because again, this is a movie, you know, you're supposed to think big for the big screen, and I didn't think this movie did that whatsoever. And I also believe part of the problem is that it's two movies in one. Rebecca Ferguson's evil crew, and they did establish that they were very evil. I didn't feel at all sorry for them. We'll talk about that in just a moment. But they have absolutely nothing to do with Danny or what's happening to him at the or what happened to him at the Overlook. Danny's like a side thing. And, you know, I guess, you know, they explain that choice, but again, we came here because it's supposed to be a sequel to The Shining. So to spend two-thirds of the movie on something that has nothing to do with that previous film, again, seems really like an odd choice. I also feel that the movie crosses the line with a child murder. It was just too much. I'm sure on the page, everybody was like, oh, this is deep and gritty. We're going to go there. And again, I felt that this scene does really solidify Rebecca Ferguson's crew as beyond redemption, right? So maybe that's the purpose of that scene. But when the child who's murdered is played by child actor extraordinaire Jacob Tremblay, so of course he's good, he really sells it, and you're watching him tied to the ground and being tortured to death, screaming for his life and for mercy, I'm surprised that when they were filming that scene, no one was like, I think maybe this is going too far. Maybe we shouldn't hire Jacob Tremblay. Maybe he's too good. Maybe we should cut away. I just felt it was too much to show a child murdered in that fashion, that graphically. Although kudos to Jacob Tremblay, who really sold it. He's a very good actor. And it's weird. They're like, because it's such a small role, he's basically just there to be murdered. Was that the selling point? They're like, oh, you want to do a really amazing like death scene? And I'm like, I don't know. I just feel like the judgment on that was off. I will say, though, that in addition to Jacob Tremblay, the entire cast of Dr. Sleep is excellent. And the acting, as you would expect, is top-notch. The directing and production design, I'd say it's a bit more Hulu. Like, this could be Castle Rock Season 3. Ewan McGregor, though, of course, is very charismatic, as always. Rebecca Ferguson also stands out. And it's great to see Cliff Curtis and Zahn McLaren, who was excellent on Fargo, not just get more work, but larger roles. They had sizable roles here, and it was great to see them. Then there's newcomer Kylie Curran, who is a real find. She's fabulous, and more than holds her own opposite established and experienced actors like McGregor and Ferguson. I thought, again, real find. I also felt that Danny's AA speech about feeling closer to his father when drunk and the actual conversation he has with his father's ghost of the Overlook were very well done and very insightful. And that was more of what I was looking for in a sequel to The Shining. I don't know why I needed all this detour. As talented as Rebecca Ferguson and Kylie Curran are, I don't know why we couldn't just focus on Danny. And, you know, more something that was going on with him. So I guess if you loved the book, The Shining, more than the movie, which, of course, by the way, Stephen King himself hated, then you too might enjoy Dr. Sleep. Or if you haven't even seen The Shining. I mean, if you think of Dr. Sleep just as its own thing, I think it's a little bit more successful. I also like the stuff about why he was called Dr. Sleep, but I felt that was like touched on so short, for such a short period of time, that it was also just, it was odd. It was, you know, I think this movie suffers from a lot of Stephen King's problems. Think less It Chapter One, more It Chapter Two, in my opinion. But if you're a big fan of Kubrick's The Shining like myself, then I think Dr. Sleep is not only a disappointment, but quite frankly, boring. So that's my review of Dr. Sleep. I'm very curious to hear your thoughts down below, since again, I think we're going to be some of us will be divided on this. Subscribe today, and of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.